Good evening, students.
Good evening.
I want to welcome you to this, our third week, Counseling the Culturally Different. As per our syllabus, we have a midterm test, I guess, after the fourth week, which this being the third week, next week will be the fourth week and the beginning of the following week. So 2 weeks from tonight, we'll have our midterm exam. You need to be thinking in terms of catching up on your reading. Tonight, we're going to be looking at culturally appropriate intervention strategies in the first session. And in the second session, we'll be looking at family counseling and therapy as they relate to the culturally different. I would like to start out tonight by giving you a breakdown between the two important aspects of counseling, or two philosophies of counseling. One is what we call the directive approach, and the second is the non-directive. The directive and the non-directive. The directive approach involves a more active therapist. The non-directive, of course, would be a more active client. The non-directive is sometimes referred to as client-centered. The directive would be a therapist-centered. And what we mean by that...
The directive would be therapist-centered?
Yeah. The directive approach... You have directive and non-directive, okay?
And non-directive is a more active counselor.
This would be more of an active therapist. This would be more of a passive therapist. This sometimes is what we refer to as therapist-centered. This could be client-centered. Your non-directive approach would come under the classification of many of the existential humanistic theories. Directive would be therapies, again, which would be, well, behavioral would be one, behavioral therapy, rational emotive therapy. We don't have time to go through all of the different aspects of these theories. Here, this would be looking at the therapist more or less as an expert. And here, the therapist would be more apt to encourage the client to find their own solutions. Or we could say client self-discovery. Now, I mention these two approaches because it's very significant in multicultural or cross-cultural counseling. Because, as a general rule, a lot of your U.S. Western culture therapy embraces a lot of your existential humanistic approaches, And this does not necessarily go over real big with different cultures. As a general rule, most of minorities are looking to the counselor as an expert. They're looking for expert advice. I think it's pretty significant that we do make a distinction here. And we talk more about these different approaches in some of the earlier classes on counseling. Okay, and what we're going to be considering tonight in the first session will be some of the differences in the way that various cultural minorities communicate. We're going to take a look now at communication styles. When you talk about communication, we're talking about verbal communication as well as nonverbal. One aspect of, again, what could I think that we'll refer to the traditional counseling approach in our Western culture. Let's just call that the dominant culture approach. Because in terms of enculturation, in terms of other cultures being assimilated into the dominant culture, which of course having traditionally been middle class white Euro-American culture, let's just simply refer to what we would call the dominant counseling approach, the approach of, well, I guess we could refer to it as Euro-American. So everybody understands what we mean by Euro-American. Every group in America is usually identified by a compound name. The first part of the name, of course, being an identification of the culture or the background that they come from. And then, of course, the second part of the compound name would be American. You have Euro-Americans, you have American Indians, you have Hispanic Americans, Asian Americans, African Americans. And then, of course, Euro-Americans are the white Americans who come from European stock. Their background is basically from Western Europe. Probably now would be a good time for us to take a look at some of the prevailing components of the Euro-American culture. Let me give you what I would consider to be the major components of this dominant culture. This would determine the values and the beliefs of this dominant culture. One, of course, is rugged individualism. We talked about individualism as compared to collectivism, have we not? Here in our Euro-American culture, we put great emphasis on individual ruggedism. The individual is the primary unit. And of course, this further implies that the individual is basically responsible. Now, let me stop here and to preface the remainder of our discussion with this statement. Now, you have to keep in mind that what we're talking about is not necessarily implying that one approach or one value system is superior to another. Now, I think that we have been led to believe that the superior approach is one that we've been accustomed to, or the one that we have been acculturated to. The American way of life, we have been convinced, is the best way of life. And I guess I would be a bit prejudiced or biased to make that statement, but I guess at this point in time that I do think that is probably the superior way of life. But if we're going to be effective counselors, we do have to be aware of other people's cultures and other people's value systems and other people's beliefs. Now, it could be that we only know one approach. We only know one system. And perhaps if we took a look at some alternatives, we might say, hey, maybe there are some other aspects that we could integrate into our culture. Now, really what has happened in the past 35 years, beginning in the mid-60s, has been maybe the integration of other cultural beliefs into the traditional American culture. Even some of your Eastern thoughts. Again, as a Christian, I would think that a lot of your, quote, Eastern thought would be counteractive or counterproductive or would be contradictory to some Christian beliefs. And yet, that's not to say that you throw it all away. There might be some aspects of other thoughts that we need to consider as being legitimate. So keep that in mind, that when we take a look at other cultural value systems and compare those systems with our traditional Euro-American system, don't insinuate that we're downing one in favor of the other. Either way. Everybody understand where I'm coming from? But again, it is important for you to be aware of other cultural values, other belief systems. And of course, you know, here in this society, we have been taught that time is of great essence, punctuality, rugged individualism, hard work, the Puritan work ethic. We take that for granted, don't we? And then we look at other laid-back cultures and we think, well, you know, they're lazy. But who are we to judge their system? I mean, we probably think we would probably like to be able to take a two-hour siesta every afternoon, but that doesn't fit into the American way of life. I mean, our way of life is busy, busy, busy. Our way of life is materialistic, is it not? We're success-oriented. We are achievement-oriented. And we put great value on those components. Another major component, so the first component that we talk about here, and I'm thinking this would make an excellent test question, probably what are the major components of the dominant white culture? Or in other words, what would be some of the values and beliefs of the major white culture? So number one would be rugged individualism. And again, a correlate to that component would be independence and autonomy. In other words, everybody ought to be self-sufficient. Everybody ought to be able to speak for themselves. Everybody ought to be able to make their own decisions. Everybody ought to be able to solve their own problems. Everybody has to be responsible for themselves. Now that sounds honorable enough. But the truth is, there are some cultures where the members of that culture are so interwoven with one another. You understand what we're saying? That there's such a collective idea that that may not be considered to be a real value. We want our kids to grow up to be independent. We want our kids to grow up and leave the nest. But you have many cultures, and even in this country, three generations ago, it was not uncommon, especially in the rural areas of our country, where two and three generations we live in the same household. And that would be a throwback to some of your patriarchal cultural system. Okay, a second component of the white culture would be competitiveness. Again, when we say the white culture, this is what we traditionally have referred to as, quote, the American way. Individualism, competitiveness, winning is everything. We want to get ahead. We want to be number one. We promote competitiveness in the schoolroom. A third component is action orientation. Action orientation. We believe in action. We have a, under this heading would be the belief that we ought to be able to control our circumstances. We ought to have control over our environment, control over nature. And we have done a pretty good job of conquering nature, have we not? I mean, we've split the atom. We've demonstrated that that we're definitely action-oriented. And then, of course, the communication or language or linguistic component is standard English. This would come under the third, or that'd be the fourth, wouldn't it? The fourth component. The fourth component is communication.
Communication.
Communication. Communication. And under communication would be standard English. We put great emphasis on being able to verbalize, do we not? We put a high premium on verbalization. We put a great emphasis, a great value on expressiveness, being able to express ourselves, to verbalize. Time is a fifth component. Time would be a fifth component. We believe in being on time. We believe in schedules. We believe in adherence to a rigid time. You know, to some cultures, and we'll look at this more in detail, but the American Indians don't operate on the same time schedule as we do. I mean, everything is by the clock. Everything is so rigid. Everything is divided down into minutes, seconds, hours, days, weeks.
There's by event, isn't it?
What's that?
In the Native American, isn't there by events?
Yeah, they're more event-oriented. Exactly. Then, of course, holidays could be another component of our culture. Holidays are very important, and most holidays are either based on Christian religion, white history, and male leaders.
Male leaders?
Yeah, male as compared to female. Our holidays are based on the Christian religion. Isn't it interesting that we probably never really stopped to think about what our own values are? We've probably never really stopped to think about what the components are of the dominant white culture. Now, we take these for granted, do we not? But when you have such an influx of other cultures coming into this country, a lot of things that we take for granted, we'll discover that there are some other people who have a different point of view. So holidays are based on Christian religion, white history, and male leaders.
Male leaders.
History.
Is that another one?
Yeah. History is based on European experience, our European immigrants' experiences in the United States. Our history, U.S. history, is basically founded on the white European immigration experience in the United States.
Okay, history based on European, U.S. history.
Well, European immigrants' experiences. European immigrants' experiences in the United States. Our history, the history books of the United States, the U.S. history books, basically, as you recall, are based on European immigrant experiences here in the United States, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how much black history have we studied? None. And most black history that you get in most of the public schools is during Black History Month, month of February, or it's offered as an option that heretofore that certain selected black students have been the only ones interested in it. But we have, since February, here in our local Christian Academy, we have taught black history 3 days a week. And it's not an option. I mean, it's a required class for blacks and whites. Okay, I've lost count of the components here.
Seven.
We're on seven?
Seven was history.
Eight is the Protestant work ethic. The Protestant work ethic.
Protestant what?
Work ethic. The Protestant work ethic. And that's basically the principle that working hard brings success. I mean, that's the way that we have basically built our nation, isn't it? Working hard brings success. Okay, the next component is one of future orientation. The emphasis in our dominant culture is basically one of future orientation. And of course, planning for the future would be included in this. The emphasis on delayed gratification. Now, delayed gratification would be the willingness to sacrifice or to put off satisfaction or gratification for some greater payoff. An example would be that you're willing to make sacrifices to train, to be trained for a better job, going to college. Okay, and I think probably the final component that we'll talk about in this lesson will be family structure. I'm going to give you several sub-components under family structure. The primary concept in the white culture is that the nuclear family is the ideal social unit. Then, of course, the nuclear family as compared to the extended family. Well, you have basically two different concepts, the nuclear family and the extended family. All right. The nuclear family is just your immediate family. That would be father, mother, and children. That's the nuclear family, your immediate family. And that's where the emphasis is in this culture, isn't it? But in many minority cultures, the emphasis is on the extended family. The extended family would be multi-generational. That could include the nuclear family in addition to grandparents, uncles, aunts, cousins. Okay. So the white culture is basically nuclear family structure. Another subcomponent under the family structure would be the concept that the male is considered to be the main breadwinner and head of the household. And of course, this would be reflective of the patriarchal structure, would it not? Patriarch means that pa is a head honcho. And then, of course, tied in with the idea that the male is a main breadwinner and the head of the household is the corresponding belief that the female is homemaker and subordinate to the husband. The female is the homemaker and subordinate to the husband. Now, I think we would all agree that there have been some very significant changes made in this country in terms of family structure, in particular since World War II, when women came into the workforce, having to work in the war factories, the war industries, while the men were away at war. And it's beginning with World War II that there has been a greater influx of females into the workforce. And that has changed the whole structure of the family. That no longer is there as much emphasis on the fact that the daddy is the main breadwinner, and no longer is there such a distinction between the roles of male and female as it once was. Now, it still is. This is still a male-dominated society and culture, but not as much so as many of your minority cultures. As we'll see, that there are other cultures that are much more patriarchal. I mean, daddy is the boss.
That's right.
And we are moving away from that concept to a great degree, but it's still pretty much considered a male-dominated society. Okay, I'll give you one more component here, and that's religion. And of course, the major religion of our culture is what? Yeah, but Christianity. Yeah, and when we're talking about world religions, we would be talking about Christianity. And of course, probably the fastest growing religion in this country is the Muslim religion. And as you have more cultures that are being brought in to the United States, you're going to have more of an influx of different religions. But we still basically refer to ourselves as a Christian nation. And of course, we Christians sometimes will take issue with that, and we will say we're anything but a Christian nation. But at least we are a Christian professing nation. And we do have a government that has basically been built on Judeo-Christian principles. Okay. So that kind of gives us something to work from. That gives us a little bit of a springboard to talk about how we would compare diverse cultures with the dominant culture. You know a little bit about some of the main components of the white culture. Okay? All right, let's take a look at communication styles and how that this can have an influence on the counseling session. Therapy is considered to be a form of communication. To have successful therapy, you must be able to send and to receive both verbal and nonverbal messages in an appropriate manner. When we look at therapy as a form of communication, it's a means of sending and receiving both verbal and nonverbal messages in an appropriate manner. One of the distinctives of the Asian approach to communication, again, we in the dominant white culture put great emphasis on verbalization, on talkativeness, on being able to express yourself, to be able to be direct and frank. We put value on that. But in the Asian culture in particular, Asians consider indirectiveness in communication as being a highly prized form of art. In other words, the more indirect they can be and the more subtle they can be, we would call it beating around the bush. But they consider that to be highly prized. They put great value and great emphasis on keeping your mouth shut. And I think the Bible has something to say about that, that in the book of Proverbs, the scripture says that in a multitude of words, there lacketh no sin. And basically what that says is if you keep spouting words out of your mouth, if you keep moving your mouth, you're going to end up sinning. You're going to sin with your tongue. And I think sometimes that we need to learn the art of being silent. We need to learn the art of listening. I think that that should be something that we should put more value on. In fact, the book of James talks about the tongue as being an untamed member of the body. In other words, would y'all agree that the tongue is going to end up getting you in trouble if you don't learn how to control it and use a little wisdom? So in some cultures, they would consider a person that doesn't talk as much as being a wise person. And we may consider this person as being out of touch, or we may think that they're ignorant. We may think that they're unresponsive. But again, they put different values on how you communicate and your verbosity than another. Okay. Asians, again, would see our directive and confrontive techniques as being lacking in respect, a crude and rude form of communication, and they would consider it to be a reflection of insensitivity. They would look at our style of communication oftentimes as being rude, crude, and insensitive. Now, you take another extreme. What really amazes me to this day is the few times that I have seen sessions of, what do they call the legislative bodies in England? You have the House of Lords and House of Commons. What do they call Parliament? Have you ever seen any televised sessions of Parliament? I mean, they sound almost totally crude and rude, do they not? I mean, you know, they shout down the speaker and then they're always yelling and responding, but they consider that to be totally acceptable. So again, it takes an understanding of different cultures. All right, nonverbal communication includes, I'm going to give you some of the means, the major means by which that we can send nonverbal messages. We can send nonverbal messages through gestures, can we not? Through the tone of your voice. Inflection of your voice, how your voice rises and falls. Another form of nonverbal communication is your posture. Your posture could be whether you lean forward, whether you lean back, whether you cross your legs, cross your arms, slump over, sit up straight. All of those are sending messages, aren't they? All of those postures are sending messages. Another type of very significant nonverbal communication could be facial expressions, eye contact. And what we want to do for probably most of the rest of our time in this session is to take a look now more specifically at how nonverbal cues are interpreted differently from culture to culture. We want to take a look at the different meanings of nonverbal communication in different cultures. It's not always easy to interpret nonverbal communication. However, if you were going to make a judgment in between the accuracy of nonverbal communication and verbal communication, which do you think would be probably the most accurate? Which would be the more accurate of the two?
Nonverbal.
See, one reason is because it's harder to lie nonverbally. You can say one thing with your mouth, but you can demonstrate something else that may be contradictory to what you've said.
Actions
speak louder than words. And oftentimes, nonverbal communication is outside the realm of awareness. So maybe a person who is sending that nonverbal message may not be aware. If they were, I'm sure that they would bring a closer alignment between what they say and how they act. Now again, in counseling jargon, congruence is the terminology that speaks about the agreement of your verbal communication and your nonverbal congruence. We say that a person is congruent when their verbal communication matches their nonverbal. Otherwise, you're sending mixed messages. And again, if you were going to make a judgment between the two, you would probably lean more toward interpreting the nonverbal as being more accurate. Okay. We're going to be looking at some terms that I am going to hold you responsible for under nonverbal communication. The first is proxemics.
We need to know about that?
Mm-hmm.
You mean we need to know about the definition of
that? Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. The second is kinesics. These are all forms of nonverbal communication. Paralanguage. And I guess we will probably, under this, we don't have a fancy name for this. I guess we could just simply say directness and frankness. Well, no, that wouldn't necessarily be nonverbal. Okay. Yeah, that would come under a different category.
We still need to know that.
What's that?
Language.
Oh, yeah. Paralanguage. And I'm going to take the time. We're going to go through each one of these and be more specific. I'll give you a definition of each of these. Again, we're going to define what we mean by each of these, and we're going to see how cultures differ. We're going to see what significance each of these has from culture to culture as far as counseling is concerned. All right, proxemics would refer to perception and use of personal and interpersonal space. So proxemics, when you talk about being in proximity or in proximity, we're talking about being in the area of, are we not? So proxemics would refer to personal and interpersonal space. And what we mean by that is that from culture to culture, the distance that two people are from each other in communication can have different meanings. So proxemics are very, very important in being able to interpret a person's behavior. Again, we're talking about nonverbal communication, are we not?
There's a commercial on TV for one of the cars that they're selling. But there's a guy that's wanting to buy this particular car, and he's just like this to the salesperson, just talking nonstop. And then he says, "Is there anything else you can tell me?" And the salesman says, "You're in my space. You need to take take a step backwards." And because he was just like this, and he says, "You're just too close." And so he steps back, and says, "That's much better." And you can see the salesman kind of adjust himself.
That's interesting. That would certainly tie in very appropriately with what we're talking about. That would be...
You see the body language out of, how people react when they're too close. You feel uncomfortable, and you can watch the salesperson. Even though it's a commercial, it's just, you can tell he's got the whole body language in with feeling uncomfortable.
Uh-huh. And that would be an excellent example that how a person would interpret another person's behavior, in particular how close they are. And we would consider if a person is closer than you would be comfortable with, you would consider that as being an invasion into your space. So that's what we mean by proximics.
Don't they say arm's length is where you're supposed to stand?
They call it boundaries. When we was in counseling, it was called boundaries. Boundaries.
Yeah, you do this, they're out of there, invading the space.
And again, that all depends on your relationship.
Exactly right.
Now, with my wife, I won't be closer than 18 inches.
That's right.
See? And, the more familiar, the more intimate you are with a person, the more comfortable you would be with closeness. But what we're talking about, again, we're talking about what would be considered to be the standard of the dominant culture, and then we're going to be comparing other cultures with that standard. Mm-hmm. Now let me give you four interpersonal distance zones that are characteristic of U.S. culture. I'm going to give you four distance zones. Well, it's under proximics, yeah.
Or interpersonal
distance zones. I'm going to give you four different settings that require a different distance. The first is intimate. Intimacy would be 18 inches and closer. And so, yes, again, 18 inches is usually, I guess it would be like an outer boundary that if you get closer than 18 inches, you're getting too close unless you're intimate. The second space is what we refer to as personal.
Personal.
Your personal space would be between 1.5 to 4 feet. 1.5 to 4 feet. And I would guess that would be a normal conversation. 1.5 to 4 feet. Social is the third zone, the third distance zone, and we refer to this as social. And that's between 4 feet and 12 feet. Between 4 and 12 feet. The fourth zone is what is referred to as public. This would be in making speeches or lectures, and that would be generally considered to be greater than 12 feet. So I guess here that we're probably within the social zone, aren't we? Now, That would be the difference, say, in having a small classroom as compared to a lecture hall of 200 students, wouldn't it? The U.S. tends to become more uncomfortable when others stand too close rather than too far away. Here in the U.S., we consider people who come in closer, we consider that to be more uncomfortable than if they were further away. We don't want people to get, quote, in our face, right? It might be something you may want to take note of. If you're viewing TV programs, movies, you might want to take a look and to see if there's a difference in the distance that people communicate. We consider that being too close as being a violation of our personal space, and we will react by withdrawing. We'll either take flight, withdraw, express anger, or consider it to be conflictual. We would consider it to be basically confronting. And then, of course, on the other hand, the more intimate you are, the more familiar you are with a person, you would allow them closer space. Now, there's something else very interesting when you're talking about space. Here in our culture, there is a type of status or a feeling of dominance with space, that a person of higher power and higher social status have bigger offices, bigger houses, bigger cars. And I think that sends a message, doesn't it? To us, that's an indication of power and status, bigness. Now, in terms of general categories of different cultures, the cultures that are basically closer or embrace a closer stance than Euro-Americans would be Latin Americans, Latinos, Africans, Black Americans, Indonesians, Arabs, South Americans, and the French.
Could you repeat that again?
Latinos, Africans, Black Americans, Indonesians, INDONESIANS, Arabs, South Americans, and French. Generally consider a closer stance as being more appropriate. Now, to show you what the implication would be, that in a counseling session, say for example, if a white therapist were counseling a Latino, the Latino coming in closer may be interpreted by the therapist as aggressiveness, sign of pushiness, and inappropriate intimacy. Wow. On the other hand, when the therapist would react to this invasion of his space, that may be interpreted by the Latino as aloofness, as coldness, or a desire not to communicate. So do you see the significance of understanding the implications of a personal space? Okay. Let's look at kinesics. Kinesics, of course. Yeah.
So in other words, if you're counseling one of these other cultures, Latinos or whatever, then as far as the distance zone, they would prefer what, a personal zone from a white counselor?
Yeah, I guess. Well, and we're only using that to basically to categorize what is considered to be appropriate as far as the white culture is concerned.
Right, but I'm just to get some general idea of how close.
Well, no, not necessarily personal. It could be that if you're in a social setting, what do we say that social?
4 to 12 feet,
and if they're 3 feet, that might be too close in a social setting. You see what I'm saying? No, you would not necessarily say that they would desire, another culture would not necessarily desire to be within 18 inches. It just simply says that whatever the setting is, they would have a tendency to be closer, okay? I'm not sure that two total strangers would feel very comfortable in being 18 inches, you know, from one another.
Most of the time, my experience has been with the different cultures, usually they let you know.
They let
their
you
body
know?
Language and all, they let you know upon y'all greeting and shaking hands. Most of them immediately let you know.
And how would they let you know?
Well, their body language tell you a lot.
What's that? Oh yeah, exactly.
A lot of your groundness.
But if you're not able to interpret that body language, then you're not communicating. So our whole point here is that we want to be aware of these different standards that are held as being quote normal by different cultures. For example, if you knew as a counselor that a Latino would have a tendency to want to be closer, that may determine how you set up your room. That may determine how you would set up your chairs. Another thing would be that, and I don't think this is good practice for any culture, I don't think a counselor ought to be sitting behind a desk.
No.
No.
But, you know, when you have a lot of agencies, they do. People feel secure. And that gives them a feeling of power. That gives them a feeling of protection. They feel like there's a barrier there. They can hide behind that desk. That puts somebody else on their terms. You know, having the feeling that somebody else brought in on your domain gives you a greater sense of power, doesn't it? But when you put yourself down on the same level, eye level, with a person with nothing between you, that puts you basically on the same footing. Okay? So it's important as a counselor for you to be aware of the different expectations of these different cultures. And you can make the adjustment. In other words, you would not interpret, if you know, if you're knowledgeable, you'll not interpret a person coming in closer as being pushy or aggressive. You say, well, that's just reflective of their culture. And of course, on the other hand, if a client was aware of these cultural differences, they wouldn't see this white therapist backing off as being coldness or aloofness. But it's basically not the client's responsibility to try to figure out how to communicate with the therapist. It's the therapist's responsibility to know how to communicate with the client. Okay, so let's look at kinesics. Of course, kinesthesis and that refers to body movements. Kinesics refer to body movements. And that is a very significant and important aspect of nonverbal communication. This would include your facial expression, posture, characteristics of movement, gestures, and eye contact. See, here in our culture, it's very significant and very important for us to have direct eye contact. But even the black culture in this country has been conditioned, you know, through slavery, to never look a white man directly in the eye. And the white man would consider that to be as confrontive. He would consider that to be aggressive. And so looking away, deferring, would be a type of submissiveness, of subservience. So eye contact has great significance. To have eye contact means that you're appropriate eye contact. Of course, you know, there's a difference in the stare and a gaze. I mean, a gaze might be lustful, you know. A stare would be considered to be very much more aggressive. I mean, if you stare at somebody, they're either going to bristle up and fight back, or they're just going to kind of cower down and kind of wander off, aren't they?
Okay.
It is right.
What about when they roll their
You know, supposedly animals, I've been told that a dog understands a stare, that you can stare even a dog down.
Yeah.
And they can pick up when you're fearful, even the way that you would make eye contact with that dog.
Mm-hmm.
I found out this, and you know, the first response for people in meeting a barking dog is to want to run, I guess. But you know, and I'm not saying I'm the bravest person in the world, but as much as I possibly can, and if I think I can get a bluff in on a dog that's coming toward me, I'm gonna start toward him.
Mm-hmm.
Now I better be in a position to take off if he doesn't back off, you know. But my whole point here is that even animals understand a certain nonverbal communications, do they not? I mean, you know, there have been times I've had dogs run out of their yard, you know, heading towards you, and I take off like I'm going after them. And
run.
Yeah, most of the time they will, but you take an aggressive dog, he's not going to. You better be picking up some cues there if you're...
Stay away.
That's right.
But the first time you show fear, you're in trouble. Okay, so kinesics are basically culturally conditioned. We assume that facial cues express emotions and demonstrate the degree of responsiveness or involvement. Would you agree with that? Facial cues basically express to us emotions, a person's degree of involvement. Let's take an example of smiling. We usually consider smiling in our culture as being a sign of liking. In some cultures, smiling may be interpreted totally different, in a totally different manner. Sometimes, I guess that all depends on what you interpret as being an appropriate smile. I mean, some people can give you that smirky smile, can't they?
Mm-hmm.
They can give you that smile that is just kind of... that could be confronted.
Especially when you're a parent.
When you're a parent?
European? Yeah, European.
What's the difference?
People, they are very nasty. I mean, they are...
Wow.
Well, see now, Connie, that is the way we have been conditioned. See, we've been conditioned that Northerners, you know, are abrupt and they're rude and crude. That may be true, but most of it is cultural.
Yes.
And if you knew that person, and if you understood the culture they come from, you would, and of course, compared, say, like certain Northerners that are what we consider to be aggressive or pushy, compared to our culture, we may misinterpret totally and completely. So what we need to understand is that it takes a knowledge and understanding where people come from and what is considered to be normal in their culture. That does not necessarily make them a bad person. Well, now, what's that little smirky smile like? What, you want to respond to that? Okay.
I guess this is part of my
part of your culture.
American thing, too.
Southern.
My Southern thing. But not even with Southerns. I guess if I can remember, if they're going to come, you know, for the Northerners to come down here, you know, and try to... take over.
Now, you know, what do you mean by taking over?
With that pushiness and that aggressiveness, you know, you want to say, if you don't lock it down here, go back where you came from.
But don't they have the same right? I mean, this is precisely, what you're saying is precisely the attitude that the Southerners had after the Civil War when the carpetbaggers came. See, I mean,
it's
in the South.
The Northerners, though, I'm finding it. I, you know.
Now, y'all remember these videos may be going to the North now, okay. And it's okay. It's okay. Go ahead and express yourself.
And I'm not as bad as I used to be, except when it comes to aggressive drivers. But But even with other cultures that come in,
uh-huh.
you know, I guess it's this thing of, I feel like if I go to another country, I'm expected to learn their ways.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And, but yet when they come here.
Now when you say they come here, you're talking about visiting or moving here?
Moving here.
Now, who's to say that they do not have the right? I mean, do we have a monopoly on this place just because we were born here? Now, I know that, hey, I understand how the Southern culture is.
No, I'm not just talking about the okay. South, though. I'm talking about the United States in general.
Yeah, and you know, we can say the same thing about foreigners coming here, and you say, well, you know, you ought to, if you want to be here, you ought to adopt, quote, our mode. But who's to say that they do not have the right to come in and establish their own mode? Now, that may go in contradiction to the majority, but if these, quote, foreigners keep coming in, they may end up being the majority, and you may be the minority. Then who do you decide is going to set the standard?
Well, I was in their country, and
I don't know.
Okay.
Be nice and how I say this, you know.
Okay, and the truth is, now here's the whole truth, is that there can be improvement on both sides, sure.
There's a certain set right now that when, you know, when you're out, they talk in their own.
When you say they now, okay.
The other culture, I'm trying to be nice.
All right.
They talk in their own native language.
Okay.
Everything is, you know, has to be geared. They stay, and I understand they're very family oriented or whatever. But they give you the impression, because they're talking in their native language, and we're having to learn their native language to be able to communicate instead of them learning ours to be able to communicate.
Okay, so that gets back to precisely what I said a moment ago, that when a client comes in for counseling, it's not necessarily their responsibility. In other words, we cannot take, if we're offering the services, we cannot make a demand on them and say, look, you're going to have to meet us on our terms. We're the professionals and we're the ones who accommodate them. And you know, the same thing is true, that if you're in any provision of services, it's your responsibility to be able, and again, it all depends on how humanitarian you are, or you know, how ministry oriented. That'd be like saying to the Spanish community, here is, bless God, if you want our God, and if you want our blessed church, and all of these things that are so wonderful about our church, you just learn English and come here and... You see what I'm saying? And so our responsibility is to accommodate the person that we're seeking to serve. Now, I'm assuming that you're probably talking about in an educational setting.
Yes, I mean, educational, and just even in general, to be living in the same community with people.
Uh-huh.
You know, you can't communicate with them because they don't speak English, and I don't speak their native language, but yet they're coming
so
here
it
to
all...
living and to learn to live here.
But you have to understand, by they're not learning this language, that they are very, very limited, see? And, you know... we don't understand maybe how much of a handicap that is to them. And the only thing they can do is to draw back in their safety and what they're comfortable with. See, they can fall back into their native language, and they can stay in their little circle. That's their comfort group. That's their security blanket. You know, put yourself in the same situation. Now, of course, you know, you'd probably say, well, if I went to Mexico, I'd learn the language. Well, that may be true, but let's just say that chances are, why in the world would you be going to Mexico? Because you're not going to necessarily be bettering yourself unless you were an oil executive, and you know what I'm saying? That you're going down there to be in a position of education or whatever. Chances are we're not going to be going to their society. They have come to our culture because they're looking for a better way of life. And of course there are people who say, well, you know, what right do they have to come take our jobs? Well, I understand people's thinking there, but there's also another point that I made in the multicultural studies, and that is that I believe that we here in America have an opportunity, as no other place on the face of the earth, to demonstrate to the world what the kingdom of God is all about. That the United States of America has been considered traditionally as being a place of opportunity, a place where we accept people of all strands of life. And you know, the truth is, our ancestors came over here for the same reason. And so, you know, we say, well, you know, we've already got our stake, and we've already have our territory, and we have our slice of the pie, and we're not going to let anybody else. Well, maybe we need to allow them to have the same opportunity that our ancestors had, see, so. And I understand mentally, intellectually, I understand where people are coming from. But I think from a kingdom of God point of view, that we also need to understand that God did not intend for us to be an island unto ourselves. There are a lot of people who, well, even through history, we have had an isolationist attitude. That let's just isolate ourselves from the rest of the world, and we'll take care of our own problems, and we'll eat our own bread and let the rest of the world go to hell. You know, let the rest of the world starve. Let the rest of the world fend for themselves. Let them, you know, solve their own problems. But that is not the point of view of the kingdom of God, or that should not be the reflection of a compassionate ministry-oriented people. You know, if people of the world are starving, that should be all of our problems. If people of the world are in need, that should be all of our problems, and especially we as Christians. And even as far as the economy is concerned, we have gotten to the place now that the whole earth is so intertwined, so interwoven, is so connected, we cannot, it's impossible for us to exist in an isolationist mode. The world is a much smaller place than it's ever been. It's more important that people learn how to understand one another. And so, you know, people come into this country to take advantage of the opportunities that are here. And again, that's a political question. It's a political issue. It's a hot potato. It becomes a philosophy. You say, well, can we feed the whole world? I guess we can try. I don't know if we can or not, but I guess we could probably try. So getting back to what we were speaking about, and it's good that we brought up this discussion because in a sense, Southern cultures have looked at Northern cultures as a totally different culture. Now let me tell you this from experience. I was born and raised, or reared, I guess is the proper term, in quote, a Southern culture, even in Northeast Arkansas, Western Tennessee, and Southeast Missouri. That is on the kind of on the fringe edge of the Southern culture, still south of the Mason-Dixon line, and still a part of the old plantation mentality. And when I came to Georgia 20 years ago, I found out something. Now, the folks in the South may get angry at some of the statements I'm going to make here. I think I can speak as a Southerner. You know, my roots are in the South. My ancestors fought for the South in the Civil War. I'm not aware of any who fought for the North. And I say for the North, for the U.S. government. What we don't understand is it was not the South against the North. It was an insurrectionist, rebellious, a group of states that broke away from the United States of America. Okay. And when I came to Georgia, I found out that Southerners are very cliquish. I found out that Southerners put great emphasis on lifelong residence.
Yep.
And it doesn't make any difference how long you are in this society, in this culture, you are always considered to be an outsider if you were not born here. I'll promise you, you will find that attitude throughout the South. People that will let you know real quick, they are a lifelong Polk Countyan.
Yes, sir.
And you can be here for 20 years and you'll still be considered an outsider.
Amen.
That's part of the Southern culture. Now I'm gonna take another little slap and then we're gonna move on. I agree that the South is considered to be friendly, hospitable, and basically good people. Now, everybody in the South is not good. I mean, we have some bigots in the South. Today, in the headlines of the Atlanta paper, I don't know, has anybody read the headlines? That they have brought to justice supposedly the final piece of the puzzle from 39 years ago of the church bombing over in Birmingham, where four young blacks were killed from a terrorist KKK setting off a bomb in a black church, killing four preteens. That's in the headlines of the paper today. Now, again, I agree that the South is hospitable, friendly. We have a different approach. We have a different demeanor. We have a different way of expressing ourselves. But you know what I've discovered? I've discovered that when a Southerner puts on that smile and say, y'all come see us sometime, don't always mean it. Yeah. Y'all come. And they put on a smile. And they'll turn around and cut you. Now, I say they. You know, that's too much of a generalization and too much of a stereotype. Y'all understand what I'm saying? Okay, so the whole point is this, that every section, every group of people, geographical group of people, ethnic groups, racial groups, have their own peculiarities related to some cultural belief. The important thing is for us to understand where people are coming from. And if you know people's hearts, I'm going to tell you this. I've told all my life, you know, the churches of the North were cold and, you know, they weren't very spiritual. That's what I heard all my life. You know, because the South was associated with a lot of emotionalism. I'm going to tell you something. Some of the most wonderful spiritual Christians I've ever come across have been some people in the North. You know, I've had an opportunity to preach to various groups in the North. They love God. You know what I found out? I found out that people are people.
That's right.
And all you need to do is to get to know people. All you need to do is go home with them. Amen. All you have to do is know their heart.
Yes.
You find out that they have some, they suffer the same way you do. They have the same pains. They have the same problems. They have the same needs, you know. So it's just all a matter of understanding. It's all a matter of communication. And that's the purpose of our studying this particular course. Okay, so facial expressions express emotions. Some Asians consider smiling may suggest weakness. Restraint of strong feelings are considered to be a sign of maturity and wisdom among Asians. Children are taught that outward emotional expressions, such as facial expressions, body movements, are discouraged except for extreme situations. Now, we have some Asian Americans here in our Christian school. When they first came to this school, they were very reserved. They were very inexpressive. And we're thinking, well, you know, we're going to break that down. We're going to, you know, we're going to change that. And they've been here about 3 or 4 years and they have changed. And I guess what has happened is that they have become enculturated. You know, but now we see that what we're trying to force on another culture may be counteracting what their culture teaches. And so it's not the matter of civilizing other people or Americanizing them or to make them to fit our mode. Head movements can mean different things in different cultures. And in fact, I think there's in one culture that moving your head like a metronome is means yes. It could, you know, or in some cultures, just moving your head one way, just one direction, may mean something totally different than it does here. So we need to understand those things. Shaking hands, the way you shake hands. What's that?
I didn't know that.
That's the reason you're here. You can't learn everything about all cultures here, but at least you can be exposed to it. You can become aware. That's the thing. Again, eye contact. What does the time say on the back there? Put your bifocals on.
15:34.
Okay, we'll go about 4 or 5 more minutes, then we'll take a break. Let's look at paralanguage. Paralanguage has to do with vocal cues that people use to communicate. Vocal cues, paralanguage. This would include loudness of voice, pauses, silences, hesitations, rate of speech. These are all vocal cues that we refer to as paralanguage. Loudness of voice. Some cultures are louder and more boisterous than others. Mm-hmm. For example, Asian Americans are basically very soft-spoken. Arabs traditionally are very loud. So, under this heading would be considerations how we greet one another and how we take turns in speaking. You know, one of the things that bugs me and probably bugs you too is a person who will not let you finish a sentence in conversation. They'll not give you respect. And I know there are times that I will respond to something and then I'll back off and say, excuse me, I didn't mean to, you know, speak up, I didn't mean to interrupt. And then you stop and give the other person the respect to continue speaking and saying whatever they're going to say. You know, you listen to some of these talk shows on TV, some of these political shows in particular, and they get to shouting at each other. And it makes me want to turn it off or flip channels. They've got to outshout, or they've got to, that's their way of getting the, it doesn't make any difference what the logic is, doesn't make any difference what the rationale is, that they win the debate if they can be overpowering and dominant. There are complex rules as to when you speak and yield to another person. Americans feel very uncomfortable with silences and pauses. We feel obligated to fill in the talk. If there, and you know, the same thing happens in the counseling sessions. That when there is a pause, the counselor feels like he's got to say something. the English, and when we say the English, we're talking about the residents of England, and Arabs use silence for privacy. The French and Spanish read silence as meaning agreement among the parties. That when they come to a pause and their silence, they take that as to mean agreement. In Asia, silence and pauses is a sign of respect for elders. And particularly for Chinese and Japanese, silence could indicate a desire to continue speaking after making a point. They make a point, they'll pause. But it also may indicate that they want to continue speaking. Again, for most Americans, there's a high premium put on expressiveness, especially verbally, on verbal expression. Now think about it. Do we not encourage our students to speak up in class, to express themselves? Isn't that a premium? We want to get them involved. We want them to talk. We want them to ask questions. We want them to express their opinion. This leads some foreigners to believe that American youth are brash, which they probably are, immodest, which they probably are, rude and disrespectful. But the truth is, here we're trying to encourage them to be verbally expressive. And for a person who does not understand that particular aspect of the culture could interpret that completely different. For the American Indian, to speak out, ask questions, or even raise one's hand in class is an act of immodesty. Let's go ahead and take a break. I still want to take a few minutes to complete our lesson here before we move into the next assignment. So why don't we take about a 10-minute break and we'll come back and conclude.